G'day YouTubers, and welcome to episode 4 of the Offshore series, Easter Strad Break. I'm going to be a little bit less ambitious this time, and I'm just going to say that I'm going to cover the group in this episode. I'd like to cover a little bit of history on the Point Lookout area, and if there's time, I'll talk a little bit about the rocky reefs around Point Lookout. I don't have much to say on them, so if I'm lucky, I'll be able to fit them in without the video running over time. We'll see how we go. We left off the last episode at Boat Rock, so it seems appropriate to start this episode with the route between Boat Rock and the group. Depending on where you start off in Boat Rock and where you want to fish at the group, it's about 1 nautical mile or less. 1 nautical mile is sort of the extreme. Say 2 litres of fuel, 2 minutes travel time, and that's at 20 knots. Obviously, you're not going to go 20 knots at the start or the finish of the trip, so, you know, allow 5 minutes, say, for the trip between them. The group is a series of rocky reefs, some of which rise above the waterline, even at low tide. They've always provided good fishing in the past, and I expect that they still provide excellent fishing now, albeit with perhaps more competition in the area. The few times I've been past this area in recent times, I've noticed a lot more boats there than used to be the case. Obviously, with more fishing pressure, there's going to be less fish around to catch, but nevertheless, I think it's well worth a try. It's very close to the bar, so you don't have far to go, and even if you're heading down to the cathedrals, if you're not trying to catch a particular tide down there, it's probably worth having a quick sound around as you go past. That ellipse that I've got flashing up on the screen just now is just highlighting the exposed portions of the group. There's a lot of area underwater, a lot more of it is underwater than exposed. I'll talk about them shortly, but before I do that, I just want to take this opportunity to talk a little bit about the history of nearby Point Lookout. And Captain Cook named the rocky headland on the northeastern side of North Stradbroke Island Point Lookout in 1770. You might think that Point Lookout means it's a lookout. You go up to the point and you look out over the ocean, but that's not the case. Captain Cook named Point Lookout as a warning to other ships to look out for the danger of rocks in the area. The first recorded landing on Point Lookout is Matthew Flinders in 1803, when he was returning to Sydney from a voyage which took him further north. He stopped at Point Lookout and sent sailors ashore at what is now known as Cylinder Beach to gather some fresh water from the local springs. In 1895, a fellow by the name of Bill North was granted an occupational license to run cattle at Point Lookout. He stayed there for a number of years, and he supplied meat to the settlement at Dunwich, the asylum at Dunwich, I should say, and I would guess also to the general settlement at Dunwich and the one at Amity. In 1902, the brigantine Prosperity was wrecked at night, about half a mile southeast of Point Lookout, and Bill North cared for 5 surviving crew members. 2 of the crew died, and they were buried in the dunes behind what is now known as Dead Man's Beach, obviously named because of. There was a proposal to build the lighthouse in 1825, but nothing came of it. It wasn't until 1932 that the lighthouse was built and a settlement was established at Point Lookout. I think a large part of that delay was probably because the pilot station was moved from Amity up to Cape Morton when they decided that the South Passage Bar was too dangerous for use. I'll just mention Cylinder Beach now. Growing up, I always thought Cylinder Beach was named because of the fantastic surfing that it provided. I knew people went over there to surf, just didn't know that that wasn't the reason it was named. See, when the lighthouse was built, it had a carbide lamp in it. And a carbide lamp is fueled by acetylene. Acetylene is stored under pressure in cylinders. If you've ever seen the oxyacetylene torches used to cut metal or weld it, you've seen the acetylene cylinders. They're the red ones, dark red or reddy brown. Because it's a flammable gas stored under pressure, it can be explosive, and I guess that's why they didn't want to store it at the lighthouse other than the bottles that were currently being used. So So they built a hut at a nearby beach to store the acetylene cylinders in, and as I say, I guess that was because of the risk of explosion. But it turns out that that hut used to store the acetylene cylinders in is the reason that Cylinder Beach got its name. Go and get the acetylene from Cylinder Beach. And there you go. How some places are named is rather trivial. Got some aerial shots of the area here from Google Earth, and I think they're worth having a look at for a couple of reasons. First of all, on a calm day at high tide, not all the rock is obvious. But when you look at it on a bit of a rough day, you can see where it's breaking, and that'll let you know where you're going to find the rock under water at high tide on a calm day. So that's one thing, just gives you an idea of where to be careful of. On the other hand, you should be careful anywhere around rocks because they could be just under the surface. So if you know there's rocks in the area, keep a good eye on your sounder and go real slow while you're hunting around looking for fish. So that's number one. The second reason is that some of these aerial shots were taken on nice calm days when the water was particularly clear, and you can see the extent of the underwater rocky reef. And that also gives you a really good idea of where you want to sound around to look for the fish. Now, it's one thing to have a look at the bathymetry maps, but I like to see these as well. It just sort of puts the whole thing in perspective for me. The bathymetry's great, but somehow just seeing this adds to it. For me, anyway. And, of course, being out on the water and having your sounder going just completes the picture. As you can see from this group of photos, it does get extremely rough out there around the group. All that white water breaking. Fortunately, any day like that is not a day you want to be on the water, so you won't be out there around the group anyway. And finally, just one more shot where the water's nice and clear, and you can see the structure of the reef underneath. If you haven't done so already, I suggest you just go back a little bit and pause the video on those shots where you can see the reef under the water. Just get a bit of an idea of the layout of it. Well, I guess it's about time to throw up some marks now. You'll need to pause the video if you want to record them, but I'll talk about them in general as they play. So you may want to just let it run through once to hear what I've got to say about them, just so you know which marks you might want to record. Now, first of all, I'll just say that, as with the boat rock area, the green marks here mark the actual rocks. They're not fishing spots. They're just GPS marks to get you to a particular rock. The blue marks there are public marks that I've gathered from the internet. At least not the three blue marks right down to the south. They're different, but the blue marks just around the area of the group, they're the ones I got off the internet. The red marks in the area of the group are spots that people have told me about. They haven't wanted them kept secret, they're just areas around the group where they found fish on a particular day. Not that you're going to go there and find fish in that exact spot any other time. You have to search around. These are just starting points around the group. And finally, those three blue marks right to the south, and not really part of the group, much further to the south than the group is, they're marks that someone's given me and told me there's a rocky reef in the area. Well, we can see that from Google Maps, so there's no secret about that. Again, not actual spots to say fish there, they're spots to say go and sound along that line, zigzag, find the fish. I will talk more about this a little bit later because this rock does break as well, although it's not quite as obvious. I'll just overlay these marks on the Navionics map now so that you can see the marks against the contours on the bottom. Also gives you an idea of what to look for on your sounder when you're fishing there. Navionics doesn't have as big a variety of marks as my program does, and they don't import well. So what I've done is the large marks there, the big pins, are the default Navionics mark. I haven't figured out how to change that, so what I've done is I've left the default Navionics mark on the green and blue marks that I had there, and I've made those little target circles the red marks, just to give you a differentiation of the marks against the bottom contour. You can make it easier to identify which is which. I'm not sure whether that's really important to you, but it's there anyway. And finally, where the white line is flashing over top of the Navionics map is the area that I think I used to fish in, because I don't have any marks back from there. That was back when I had the old GPS, and while there were some marks on it, I didn't get them all. I don't think they exported, to be honest, in those days. I think you had to write them down on paper, and I never took the trouble to do that. I just assumed the GPS would always be there, and was quite surprised when it died one day and I no longer had my marks. Lesson learned. But what you can take away from this is that that white line there is a good area to start sounding around that. I never really fished on the southern side of the group. It may be an excellent area. I can't comment on that. There are some marks down there, so have a look at that as well. Now I'll just run a few aerial shots from Google Earth of that patchy reef down to the south of the group, just so you can see that that does break in the right weather, so you need to be careful around that. The rocks are close to the surface as well. And always remember, when you're fishing around rocks like this anywhere, you have to have one eye on conditions, another eye on the rocks. You need to have a good motor that you can rely on starting every single time. You need to have a good anchor. Now, I'm just ever so cautious around these sorts of things because I can't afford to replace a boat because I was careless enough to lose it on a group of rocks. Now, accidents do happen, but you've got to do everything you can to prevent them. Otherwise, it could end up being a very expensive exercise. This group of pictures on that patchy piece of rocky reef is also very interesting in that it shows you how the reef covers up and uncovers from the sand moving around that area. You can see that in the shots from Google Earth, or at least the ones where the reef isn't breaking too much and the water's fairly clear. Gives you a good idea of what's happening on the bottom. It changes all the time. Now that we've covered all the marks in the area and talked a bit about safety, let's go back to the group and have a really close look at what's there. Just looking at the habitat in the area, there's a lot of rocky area around Point Lookout itself, in particular around the gorge area. It's not a place that I've ever considered fishing in a boat. I think it'd be great for land-based fishing, but it's certainly spectacular on the days when it's pretty rough and the waves are racing down the gorge. When I was flying in that area, I used to go down a little bit low and just watch that as I went past. Pretty beautiful, really. But not the sort of place you want to fish if the weather's a little bit rough. And, as I said, not the sort of place that attracts me for fishing with so many other opportunities offshore. You don't need to go too close to those rocky areas that are close to land, the waves coming in. On a calm day, they're probably fine. But I can't say I'm really comfortable fishing too close to rocks where the current waves, wind are likely to blow me into the rocks. I prefer fishing on the other side where the current waves and wind are going to take me away from the rocks if anything goes wrong. I'll zoom in here on the area of the group though, and we'll just go through all the different sorts of structure there are there on the bottom. Plenty of opportunities for fish to find a home there, that's for sure. I put some captions up in the top left-hand corner to show you just exactly what each of the colours means on the bottom. Have a good look at them. I haven't marked the islands here. We'll get to that in a minute and show you where the actual rocky islands are in relation to all this. But it just gives you a feel for what sort of bottoms to expect. If you know what sort of bottoms to expect, you know where to sound around looking for the fish, particularly if you have in mind to target a certain species. This is the same information on the benthic habitats that we just saw, only this time I've overlaid it on top of the aerial photographs using my application, so that you can see where they just sit in relation to the rocky islands. This is a mud map that's put out by one of the dive clubs that go to the group. North isn't up, there's an arrow there indicating which way north is. While it only covers a small area of the group, it does tell us something about the predators that are hanging around there and the water depths that they're hanging around in. So every bit of information is helpful. This next image is again from one of the dive clubs, but it's even harder to interpret because it doesn't even have a north arrow. I think the north arrow would be pointing up and a bit to the left. But what is interesting about this map is it shows there are small and large boulders on the bottom in various places. Should be able to find them on your sounder if you've got a down imaging sounder or a side imaging sounder. And of course, finding the structure is halfway to finding the fish. Although with all the rock in the area, there's no shortage of structure. And finally, I'll just play some images of underwater scenes from around the group, just so you can see for yourself the bottom structure there. I haven't got the locations of any of these pictures, but you can see just how diverse the structure is down there. I've said in the past that it's not a bad idea to do a bit of scuba diving or even snorkeling around just to see what the structure's like under the water and to get an idea of how the fish behave around it. I've found it very interesting to do that in the past. Really fascinating to watch as a snapper hides under a small bommie and then darts out to grab a passing squid. He's got the squid down his gullet and the tentacles hanging out of his mouth. Looks really funny. And then he'll swim away a little bit, stop, and gulp the rest of it down. And I found that interesting because it tells you you can leave your drag pretty loose, let it run for a bit, and as soon as it stops, tighten it up, because that's when he's gulping it down. When he takes off again, he's hooked. That's just one insight I gained from doing a bit of snorkeling. I couldn't say I've done a lot. There's lots of people who've done a lot more than I have. But I found what I have done was fascinating, interesting, and educational. Failing that, have a look at these pictures and get an idea for the structure down there. You should be able to recognise the various structures on your sounder if you've got down imaging or side imaging. And once you've found the structure, you can look for the fish. Well, that's it for this video. I'm going to wrap it up now. I did manage to cover the group and that little bit of patchy reef south of it. So I'm pretty happy with what I've got in this video. I hope you got something out of it. It was a great spot to fish back in the day, although it's been quite a few years since I've fished it. I tend to fish a lot east of Moreton these days. Prior to that, I used to go north of Moreton a lot when I had Wave Dancer. This always was a good fishing spot, and it can't be too bad because a few times I have been out past it, I've seen quite a few boats in this area, fishing around Shag Rock, Bait Rock, The Group, 1 Mile, Sevens Reef, Middle Reef. It all seems to be very popular still, and someday soon I'd like to get back down there and give it another go. One thing that has changed over the years, though, is these days I'm much more cautious about fishing around rocks than I used to be. I used to fish in front of rocks where there was a chance that if something went wrong, the prevailing current would take me into the rock, and it did always concern me, but I sort of had more faith in things working right than I do now. Perhaps I have too much imagination now, but I do imagine what could go wrong that I didn't imagine when I was younger. And now I'm really very cautious about it, so I tend to fish on the lee side a lot more. Bottom line is, if you're going to fish around rocks, be real careful. I'm going to cover a lot of these other areas I just mentioned in future videos. Until then, good fishing.